In this experiment, we will use visible absorption and emission spectroscopy to record the vibronic spectra of iodine. As the name might imply, we'll be analyzing the vibrational structure that is built onto electronic states. We'll analyze these spectra in order to quantitatively determine ground and excited state parameters of iodine, such as the dissociation energies, force constants, and the anharmonicities of the electronic states. To prepare for this experiment, you should read the experimental handout and all references given within the handout. We'll refer to the HCl-DCl experiment at several points, so you may want to watch the Rho vibrational spectroscopy and HCl-DCl spectroscopy videos as well. In the HCl-DCl experiment, we observe vibrational levels of an anharmonic oscillator. Let's start by diagramming it. On this diagram, the x-axis describes the internuclear separation, R, and the y-axis is the potential energy, V of R. We'll label a few important items on this diagram. The vibrational levels of the anharmonic oscillator are shown in red. Note how these levels get closer together as we go to higher states. The highest vibrational level, V max, is a state that coincides with the dissociation of the bond. The energy required to reach this state can be measured from two different points, the bottom of the curve, which is called dE, or from the V equals zero level, called d0. These values are highly dependent on the shape of the potential. The lowest rotational levels associated with the V equals zero state are shown in blue. Although we are able to observe rotational structure in HCl-DCl, we'll not have sufficient resolution to observe the rotational structure of iodine, so we'll mostly ignore it in our discussion. In electronic spectroscopy, we deal with transition between electronic states. Let's compare the parameters of two electronic states. We'll add some labels to keep our parameters separated by state. We'll give a prime to our upper state and a double prime to our lower state. Remember, the differences in the two states is due to the rearrangement of electrons between the two states. This leads to changes in the magnitude of the equilibrium bond length, Vmax, and the dissociation energies of the two states. The selection rules for electronic spectroscopy are more complicated than those of Rho vibrational spectroscopy. For the sake of simplicity, we'll say that the molecule can absorb a photon to go to any vibrational level in an allowed, excited electronic state. Now let's see how we can move around this system of states. In this example, we have a molecule with one quanta of vibrational energy in the electronic ground state, which can absorb a photon to go to V equals 0, 1, 2, or 3 in the excited electronic state. When we record the absorption spectra, we will see a peak that corresponds to each of these transitions. As iodine is quite massive, we can expect a very low vibrational frequency as compared to HCl. Because of this, we'll find actually some vibrationally excited states that are populated even at room temperature. Let's look at this by application of the Boltzmann distribution. If we assume the vibrational frequency of iodine were 200 wave numbers, and the degeneracy of the states is 1, we find a Boltzmann factor of 0.381. signifying a significant occupation of V equals 1 vibrational level. In a harmonic approximation, we would expect a Boltzmann factor of 0.145 for the second vibrationally excited state. This tells us that we should expect to see absorption transitions that originate from the V equals 0, 1, and 2 vibrational states. Iodine can absorb from any of these three vibrational states to the excited electronic state. Since the Boltzmann distribution tells us that higher V double prime states have a smaller population, we should expect lower intensities of these transitions from these higher states. The intensity of transitions from a particular V double prime state is also influenced by the wave function overlap of the two vibrational states, which is called the Frank-Condon factor. We'll learn more about the Frank Condon factor later in another experiment. We'll focus on one absorption transition, say to V equals 1 in the excited state. What happens now? Low energy is favored throughout chemistry, so the state populated by absorption will spontaneously decay. There are a multitude of pathways that a molecule can follow that lead from the excited state back to the normal Boltzmann distribution. These pathways can be classified as either radiative or non-radiative, meaning do they emit a photon or not? In this experiment, we'll observe the radiative pathway, also called emission. In a sense, this is going back the same way we came. However, there's a substantial difference. The excited molecule is not required to emit a photon of equal energy to that which was absorbed. It only has to emit a photon that takes the molecule to some vibrational level of the ground electronic state. So we could go from our excited state V prime equals 1 to V double prime of 0, 1, or any other seemingly random state. The probability to go to a particular state is dictated by the Frank Condon factor. In this experiment, you will record and analyze the absorbance and emission spectra of iodine. The absorbance spectrum will be recorded using a standard UV-Vis spectrometer, but the sample cell is not the standard square cuvette that you have used in previous experiments. We're probing a molecule in the gas phase, and gas phase molecules are less dense than in the solution phase, so we need a much greater path length in order to observe an appropriate instrumental response. This is in accordance with the Beer-Lambert law. The sample cell shown here is 10 centimeters long, has quartz windows, and it can be closed to the atmosphere with a stopcock. A few iodine crystals will be placed in the cell prior to your arrival in the lab. This will allow the iodine to sublime and equilibrate. After several hours of equilibration, a purplish color will be observed in the cell. The emission spectrum will be recorded using an emission spectrometer, also known as a fluorimeter. As noted previously, there are other ways beside emission to exit the excited electronic state. The non-radiative pathways in iodine are favored at a higher pressure. In this case, higher pressure is generally greater than 350 millitorr. Remember, atmospheric pressure is roughly 760,000 millitorr. This means we'll have to specially prepare our sample for emission spectroscopy so that the radiative pathway is easily observed. Since emission is a much more sensitive technique than absorbance, we can use a smaller sample cell to record the iodine emission spectrum. A standard quartz cuvette has been attached to a special fitting that allows it to be connected to a vacuum manifold. This manifold is similar to that used for the HCl-DCl experiment. One significant difference here is the pumping system. As noted, pressure is an important variable in this experiment. The pumping system on this vacuum line is designed to achieve pressures less than 1/1000th of a millitorr. The vacuum system uses two pumps in series. The first pump, the same type used to evacuate the HCl-DCl cell, is called a rotary vane pump. It lowers the pressure inside the system to less than 10 millitorr. Rotary vane pumps are very common and are the usual lab workhorses. The second stage pump is called a diffusion or gas jet pump. This pump only functions when the pressure inside the system is less than 100 millitorr. In other words, we need the rotary vane pump to lower the pressure sufficiently for the diffusion pump to function. Please note, what follows is not meant to be a step-by-step instructions, but rather a simple description of how we fill our emission cell. You should not attempt to use a vacuum line without proper training and supervision. Before filling the sample cell, the manifold system must be pumped down so that the diffusion pump will function properly. We start this process by turning on the rotary vane pump to remove most of the atmosphere in our system. We've already installed our sample cell to an empty manifold port using an O-ring and a clamp. The manifold valves to our cell and our sample are open, as well as the cell valve, but the valve on our sample reservoir is kept closed. We wouldn't want to pump our sample away. The rotary vane pump will bring our pressure down to less than 100 millitorr, which is sufficient to start the diffusion pump. This vacuum gauge is connected near the diffusion pump and is used to make sure the working pressure is always low enough that the diffusion pump functions properly. We have a second vacuum gauge that is connected directly to the manifold. We'll use this gauge to monitor the pressure of the gas that we're putting into our sample cell. With the system evacuated, we'll fill a dewar around the trap with liquid nitrogen. This will keep the corrosive iodine from entering our vacuum pumps. Now we're set to activate the diffusion pump. Our diffusion pump requires cooling water. With water flowing, we can plug in the diffusion pump. It takes about 30 minutes for the pump to reach its operating temperature and maximum vacuum. Be careful around diffusion pumps. They get hot. What to do with 30 minutes? Now that the pump is at its operational temperature, the pressure on the manifold should be less than 10 millitorr. The final step before filling our cell is to degas our iodine sample. To do this, we freeze our sample in liquid nitrogen, pump on the sample, and then thaw it. We repeat these steps multiple times. This is called freeze-pump-thaw cycling. We usually do this 3 times to make sure we remove any absorbed gas that might interfere with our measurements. In this case, we're mostly worried about oxygen, which can efficiently shut off emission pathways in our sample. With the sample degassed, we can proceed with filling our cell. At this point, the process is very similar to that of filling the cell in the HCl-DCl experiment. Our final pressure of our sample will be roughly 220 millitorr. With our sample cell filled, we can remove it from the line and acquire an emission spectrum. Please refer to the handout for further details on recording the spectrum. After watching this video, you should be able to answer the following questions. Why do we expect transitions from multiple vibrational states in the ground electronic state? Why don't we use a standard cuvette for the absorption experiment? Why do we need a high vacuum to prepare our sample for emission spectroscopy?